And action!
Hello and welcome to episode 341 of the Filmmakers Podcast. This is a podcast where we talk
filmmaking,
from indie film to studio films and
high-end TV and everything in between.
How to get them made, how to make them, and how to try not to
royally F them up.
In our very, very humble opinion. Today on the show, we have fantastic director and producer team, Rob Marshall and John DeLuca.
It's pretty exciting. We've also got my merman himself, Giles Alderson.
And my fellow merman, Dom Lenoir, hosting with me.
And even more exciting, it's actually a TV filmed interview. So the hype levels are even higher than usual.
I like that you say TV filmed. It's like, it's YouTube filmed.
I know the terminology.
It's filmed for YouTube. It is on our YouTube channel, The Filmmakers Podcast. Do go search for that. I'll try and put something in the show notes, but to be honest, I probably won't have put it up on YouTube by the time the podcast goes out. But
might be a cheeky clip, though.
There might be a cheeky clip online, and that is the main thing on our socials, The Filmmakers Pod on Twitter and The Filmmakers Podcast on Instagram. Follow us there for all the latest, greatest news. But anyway, more importantly, Rob Marshall, John DeLuca, these are legends of the game. These are fantastic, fantastic filmmakers. For instance, Rob Marshall is the director of the Academy Award-winning Chicago, Memoirs of a Geisha. Mm-hmm. He's also directed Nine, Pirates of the Caribbean on Stranger Tides, Into the Woods, Mary Poppins Returns, and The Little Mermaid. And John DeLuca has produced all those films with Rob Marshall. That's pretty impressive. What a team. What a team. And we were lucky enough to sit down with them and chat all about how they make their films, but mainly about Disney's latest release, The Little Mermaid. Dom Lenoir, what did we talk about with the fantastic Rob Marshall and John DeLuca?
We talked about shooting on a water stage at Pinewood Studios.
Woo!
We also discuss shooting virtual backgrounds for underwater, and we talk about shooting a huge action sequence at sea with explosions, which they may have learned something about on those Pirates of the Caribbean films.
They may have indeed. We also dive into the casting of this, how important it was to get the casting right. This is based on a ridiculously famous
based on a true story
of the Little Mermaid who came to land. No, it's not. It's based on an animation, and you'll know it, of course. Let's sing the song, Tom.
Under the sea. That one.
Yeah?
I just have those three words on repeat in my head ever since I watched the film. Sometimes I treat Giles to a one or two second audio message of that.
Oh,
just out the blue.
And it is a treat. Let me tell you.
It is.
And we also talk about the long-standing collaborations that they have had with each other, but other people as well, and how their previous work made them perfect for The Little Mermaid. Oh, it's a great episode. And like Dom said, it was a TV filmed interview as well. So there was extra pressure on us.
Filmed on the telebox.
Filmed on the telebox, just for you.
Yeah, you can probably see the panic in our eyes in like the first minute or two of the interview.
It's so hard to get that first.
We're the ones that have to like do the thing as well. Like when you're interviewed, it's quite fun because it's like you get asked questions and you talk about the thing that you've done and you get through loads of them. And when you're the interviewer, it's like, oh shit, we've got to do something good here.
Yeah, you've got to come up with funnies and witties and stuff like that. But
yeah,
to be fair, both me and Dom came up with a brilliant pun at the same time, and it was a race to see who could say it. You can see us waiting. Here we go. You'll find out who won that particular battle when you listen to the podcast, or you watch it on YouTube, on the Filmmakers Podcast YouTube channel. Yes.
When it's like really, really, really big guests, and unless we're really sort of jumping into the jokes, I just tend to deploy the puns, but I don't leave a gap, and sometimes they don't know that it's a pun. So if anyone's listening and they hear a pun and they're like, was that a pun? He didn't sort of play it like a pun. It was always a pun.
It's Dom Lenoir, ladies and gentlemen. It's always a pun.
We had good fun at this this TV filmed interview.
We did.
We saw the Little Mermaid herself.
We did. Halle Bailey is her name.
Did the very British raise eyebrows, sort of partial nod smile and got something similar back.
Is that what you did?
Probably slightly more graceful.
Yeah, right. That's right.
I said hello.
Well, I said hi.
And Jonah Hoa King, I think you were so enamoured with your Halle weird eyebrow raise thing that you're talking about that you didn't see Jonah Hoa King, who plays Eric, because I did, and I went, hello, and you walked on.
Oh, okay, yeah.
But then you didn't see Melissa McCarthy, and you did, so I must have been in awe of
Jonah. Yeah, she blanked me.
She blanked you?
She did look very, like, serious, like, for someone that's a comedy actor, she looked like she was, like, seriously prepping for an interview in, like, business mode.
She probably thought she was coming to exchange puns with you, and she was like, well, I've got to be on my A game now, because this guy.
Exactly.
This guy. And then we chatted to Javier Bardem.
Yeah.
For a few seconds.
And I think the comment was, oh, Giles, look, there's Javier. You know, there he was, looking at his own poster.
Yes.
And he just sort of looks around, he's like, oh hello.
You caught me looking at my poster.
He does have that kind of voice. He's like, yes, it's a bit of a likeness. He says something like that in his, unfeasibly handsome, powerful, masculine form.
Yes.
He's a handsome guy. When you see him, you know, I'm a straight man, but Javier is a man.
What?
You know, he's a real man.
Yes, he is. Absolute wonderful guy. I actually really enjoyed this film. Me and Dom were nudging each other and giggling like little men.
Yeah.
Enjoying the film, really reminiscing, because it's really good. There's no question about this. It's a really fun adventure. A family fantasy, and I think this will do really, really well and make a lot of money. It's number one on IMDb at the moment as well, by the way. I imagine it's made a fortune already. It's probably made its budget back.
Washing away the competition.
There we go. If you don't know the story, it is of the Little Mermaid. It is a young...
Based on a true story.
It is based on a true story about a young mermaid who makes a deal with the sea witch to trade a beautiful voice for human legs so she can discover the world above water and impress a prince. Based on a true story by David McGee.
We've all been there. We've all been there.
We have all been there. Oh, by the way, if you do like this, go onto our Patreon page and support us there. There's even more fun and banter and more dumb puns that I cut out that are in the Patreon page. So go there
and have
some more fun at Dom's expense. No, at my expense for cutting out some great puns. So thank you so much for listening. You're all amazing people. By the way, if you noticed, last week's podcast went out on Wednesday rather than Tuesday. Some of those eagle-eyed viewers would have known.
This is what happens when I'm not around. I miss one episode, and 300 and something, 350 something, 40. Whatever it is, episode, 340 episodes of perfect Tuesday deployments go out the window. It's a free-for-all. So,
The reason for that was Cam. We'll come to that at the other side of this. But first of all, let's play the trailer, shall we? And then, at the other side of that, it'll be myself, Dom Lenoir, talking with Rob Marshall and John DeLuca. Sit back, relax, and enjoy.
Sink or swim.
As we go under the sea.
Under the sea.
All hands on deck! Abandon ship!
Drowning. I had to save him.
This obsession with humans has to stop.
I just want to know more about them.
Ariel! Don't!
Poor child.
I can help you. You can't live in that world unless you become a human yourself.
Is that even possible?
It's what I live for.
Something about you seems different. I can't
quite figure it out.
She got legs, you idiot.
I don't know where, I don't know how, but I know something's starting right now. Watch and you'll see.
A human, you're a mermaid.
That doesn't make us enemies.
Fantastic.
Speeding.
Great. How are you guys doing? All
we're
right.
good. We're so good. Happy to be here.
Yeah.
Trying to get on the time zone here.
Well, that's an impossibility. I've given that up.
So. Yeah. Sometimes best, isn't it, to just go.
Just let it go.
Yes.
Just
let it go. Exactly. Yeah.
Wrong song, but anyway.
Wrong song. Exactly. Same studio.
Under the sea.
There we go.
It's quite relaxing, actually. The sea. Your backdrop, you don't get to enjoy it as much as us, but it's very relaxing.
We're watching yours,
too. Yours is, too.
Oh, okay. You do get to enjoy it.
It's an immersive experience.
Yeah. Immersive, as we see.
Hopefully we'll get flooded at some point and then the mermaids will join us.
Yeah, that was fascinating because at times I was like, how do they breathe? You know, the question comes in your mind. Oh, how do they breathe?
Well, that was all done on a blue screen stage because, well, we had to sing and speak, as you say. You had to breathe.
Yeah.
So we realized right from the very beginning that's how we're going to have to do this. We had to create an entire environment digitally. So everything, every strand of hair is added. All the backgrounds, the water, of course, the vegetation, all of it was all added afterwards. But it was all designed in advance, so we knew exactly what it was going to look like. But even some of the costumes, obviously the tails, but even like Ariel's top, that's all digital because she was basically just in a little tank top and shorts because of how it had to move. You know, there was like a little ruffle there and that had to move in the water. So it was the most challenging film we've ever done, no question.
The prep, you kind of went over that very quickly, but the prep on this movie, we had to find out these things in advance. Yeah. Yeah. The prep was
massive.
Enormous.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But it freed us up on the day, so everyone knew what they were doing.
We almost did like a little pre-movie before we actually even went into rehearsals. We had because everybody was in some kind of rig. You were either on wires or on what's called a tuning fork. You're inside a disc where you can spin with a massive crane arm. Mm-hmm. And every person, every actor had about 8 to 10 people moving them around.
Stunt people.
Wow.
So they had to know every breath and every line.
And every count.
They had to know how they...
Musically, musically they had to know when to move, because it was all a lot of it's to music. Mm. But you don't see any. I mean, our goal the entire time we were working on this film was to make sure that no one saw the technical aspect of it. I mean, that was the goal, because it was very easy to make this entire technical exercise. Yeah. But we felt like it was... it was really important to make sure that the acting and the story and all of that, the character work, was all front and center, as opposed to all the difficult technical part of it.
I totally think you pulled it off. Mm. I mean, I didn't know that.
We were wondering like how we're filmmakers. We were wondering how they were breathing and talking.
Oh, that's good. So you thought they were really underwater?
It genuinely does look like it.
We did. We did some underwater work, but it was only with Eric. You know, so he's the actual human.
Yeah.
So there was some of that. And then obviously anytime we broke the surface and we were in water, that's
real
all real water in Sardinia, because that's where we were. But we did some tank work too in Pinewood, like the shipwreck and all that kind of thing. That was all that was with a huge wave machine and a small tank.
Right. And we were so lucky that Hallie was a swimmer. And she was such a great swimmer.
Yeah.
Did you ask her?
I mean, did you ask her before?
Yeah, was that part of the casting?
You know what?
Process?
It's interesting. There were so many things she needed to be in advance.
Yeah,
so many things. So she had to be,
mermaid.
Obviously, a
mermaid. Yeah.
A tail, please.
And she really needed to sing like she does.
Yeah.
Because it's part of the story, too. You know, that voice needs to be
something. A gift. Yeah.
But on top of that, she needed to be strong and vulnerable at the same time. Mm. So it wasn't just strength, but also kind of wide-eyed innocence.
Yeah. Otherworldliness we wanted.
Yeah. And also we needed someone who had passion, too, a great deal of passion. When she first auditioned for this, I'll never forget, she walked in. I mean, it's crazy to say this, but we'll say it. She was the first person we saw for this role.
Wow.
She walked in. She sang for us. She said, would you like me to sing or read first? And we said, whatever you prefer. And she said, I'll sing first, you obviously being a singer. Mm-hmm. And I remember she shut her eyes and started to sing Part of Your World for us. And by the end of it, I was in tears.
I looked over the tears were streaming down.
I mean, I just couldn't believe how moved I was. I mean, she's so connected to the lyric and to the feeling. Mm-hmm. And she set the bar so high right from the start. And then we saw everybody else, like hundreds of women, but she had set the bar so, and she kept coming back over and over again.
And originally we did have an inkling because we had seen her on a television show. We were just watching the Grammys, and we asked to see her. So that's why we had seen her first.
Yeah,
because there's something there, we'd seen the presence.
Yeah.
And the,
but it was incredible to sort of go through the entire casting process and then realized the first person we saw was it. And then we did a screen test, and it was fantastic. We sent the screen test to Disney. They said yes within literally moments. It was so obvious. I mean, my goal always as a director is to never have to choose. My goal is if we can just sort of, you know, someone can come in and claim the role, so there's really no choice. It was so obvious that she was the one.
And all actors say they can do everything. I mean, can you? We've done this before. Mm-hmm. Can you ride a horse?
Yeah.
And they, I never. It's like, so when we did say, "Do you swim?" It's like, yeah. My parents had a pool, you know, wherever. But then I'd be in the water and showing her things. I'm a swimmer, and so I would show her how to dive and how to go in. And she would like, oh my god, just like that.
Yeah, natural athlete.
So that was, we really had.
Yeah, that was lucky.
Yeah, yeah.
That
you lucked lucky. Out, I think.
Lucked
yes.
out
yeah.
on
yes.
that.
Yes, yes,
yeah.
we
she
did.
Was like that's outstanding as a performer, yes. but also, like, I was thinking, she must be able to do so many things.
So what, many
were
things.
You trying to prioritize the singing as the sort of the primary thing, or were you looking at the drama scenes as well? Like, I mean, how do you sort of?
It needed
choose?
To be everything, yeah. really. I mean, obviously, the voice is key, and normally, John and I work with actors who sing. I mean, Melissa McCarthy, you know, that's
the list
a perfect
goes
example.
On all of our films.
All of our films. I mean, in this film, Melissa, but it was sort
telling
of...
telling the story.
I mean,
really
Jonah, who plays Prince Eric, is an actor who sings. But rarely do we sort of work from the other side. But we knew we needed a great singer. And then she, you know, then she read for us. And what was incredible to see is that although she was rather green in many ways, it was so clear that she was so engaged about the work and was like a sponge. So we would give her direction, we would give her ideas and thoughts and what to play, and she was a sponge, and she was watching everybody.
During rehearsals?
Watching Javier Bardem, watching
She's
Melissa.
Very serious. I would watch her watch, because I wanted to see how she would be with these other actors, and it was just, she would just watch them and just take it, and she's very bright, as you say.
Yeah, and she also has a sense of, I think, you know, how much to do, you know, knowing that the camera picks up so much, so you don't need to do that much. So she has like a taste about that.
She knew to trust that. Well, you also encouraged her to trust that. Mm-hmm.
But it was important that, you know, I mean, just, you know, you feel it. And it was always about keep it very real. I mean, I know this is crazy, but it was really important for us to make this fantastic world under the water very real. So that, because for me, if you don't believe the people you're watching and don't believe the world, you're not engaged, and you feel like it doesn't feel real. So you're not engaged. We want people to be moved by the story. It's such a classic, beautiful piece. I mean, when John and I started this whole journey, we went directly to Hans Christian Andersen. First thing, and we saw immediately this incredibly modern story. I mean, it was written in the 1830s.
Very timely to us when we read it. Yeah,
very timely. Because it felt like someone who felt displaced, didn't feel they belonged.
Total outsider.
And learned not to be afraid of someone different than her, like an entire culture that's different than she. And it was sort of like, well, isn't that kind of what we're dealing with now in the world?
In a world where we face so much xenophobia. Mm-hmm. And fear of the other, and from parents and from our the structure of our worlds, our countries.
Yeah, so the divisiveness in the world, it feels like it's increasing. Yes. So in a way, this was such an antidote to that, making this film the entire time about not being afraid of someone that's different than you. And then with the character of Eric, which in the animated film was rather wooden, you know, rather sort of, well, you know, sort of not developed.
We
thought we could develop that story so that you would have a character who was like a kindred spirit for her, they would fall in love not just because of superficial looks or anything like that. They would have something deeper than that, like a connection about feeling somewhat misplaced, also feeling like they wanted to adventure and break past, you know, their own sort of barriers and find each other, and it became
Romeo and Juliet kind of tale.
Yeah, it did.
It was very important to us too, as while we were writing, that we didn't want her just to see this beautiful man and fall in love with him. We wanted her to hear his passions and what he believed in mm-hmm. before she, you know, understand what's who he is as a person. Mm-hmm. So she's hearing on the boat, she hears what he's saying, and it's like, I get this person. There's something more than meets the eye.
There's a connection, and then they find each other, that they are deeply connected, and so they go through, you see what they go through to find each other ultimately, you know. It's like the hardest hardest journey ever.
Yeah, like fish out of water.
I was just about to say.
Yes.
Absolutely. It really is a fish. This really is a fish out of water.
Yes, absolutely. We're talking, and absolutely felt that way as well, and it was really nice that came across with Prince Eric, that he wasn't, you know, just one-dimensional.
And just this handsome guy.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And it was so nice when that got layered in with, oh, that's not his mum, that's someone else.
Yes, that was,
he's a fish out of water as well.
We had fun giving that backstory to him.
Well, I felt like, you know, this is a different genre, you know? I mean, I think that's important for people to know who obviously love the animated film, but this is a different genre, so you have to actually deepen it, you have to expand it, it has to be more emotional. You have all those opportunities to have a bigger, emotional experience when you're watching it, you know?
And we were lucky to find Jonah, who has this depth and this earnestness and serious nature. He's just a great guy. I think that comes across in the film.
Yeah.
And he doesn't take it lightly. He is very handsome and very appealing, but also he's very connected to his purpose and what he believes is right, and he wants to change. He doesn't just want to follow.
As a person, who knows?
Yeah. Maybe as a person too.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think you bring a lot of yourself to every role you play, obviously, and this is who he is actually naturally. He's just such a lovely guy. But on top of that, he's such a good actor. And, you know, that was our goal, really, to find these, to make this a sort of a fuller story between the two of them. And so you're rooting for them, you know, throughout.
They were both very, pure. And I think that really comes off. Like, they're both two very pure people. And maybe the people around them aren't as much, or they're sort of getting on the way.
That's true.
How did you sort of build those relationships with the two of them? Did you try and keep them away from each other so the magic was fresh, or did you let them spend a bit of time with each other?
It was more spending time with each other. I mean, they screen tested together too, and it was really important to see if there's chemistry. You could see that they're well, you see immediately.
You never know.
Yeah, you don't.
But on the day, they were immediately friends.
Right.
And obviously, that's what's the basis of this relationship, is a deep friendship and shared interests, right? So, and they had that naturally. You could see it on screen, you know, whether, you know, the little moments that they play, and I think that all comes from this wonderful relationship they actually have in real life.
Yeah,
it just blends into that, especially because, you know, throughout this entire sort of relationship, she doesn't have a voice, so. It's sort of like it's deeper than that. You find something deeper than just sort of like a superficial kind of look or whatever. There's something, the shared feelings. And they were very special together. I mean, it was very obvious. Once again, we didn't have to choose. When you could see, it's like, well, there's the chemistry right there. Yeah.
And the way Rob works, and thank God, we have a lot of rehearsal time. And a lot of actors are afraid of that because they feel that they'll be penned in by what they find, but it's just the opposite. Mm. It's just to get layers and depth and get to know someone and to find out the parameters, and to make horrible mistakes and fools of yourself. And I think everybody felt very comfortable.
Yeah.
So that on the day when he says action, they are free to do anything. They're never locked in. And we're always encouraging, even in the moments. Mm-hmm. We want those mistakes. We want that
spontaneity.
Oh, God, but it's crucial.
But you built the foundation, exactly. Right.
It's really crucial. And that's how they got to know. That's how all the characters got to know each other, even the ones with the a fish and a crab and a bird.
Yes,
they would be there in the scenes.
Yeah, we had rehearsals with them in the space with us. So, for instance, David Diggs, who plays Sebastian, was in rehearsals with Javier, with Hallie. You know, you can't just fly in, do a couple lines, and leave. There's no relationship there. They were part of the rehearsal process. So was Awkwafina.
Awkwafina and David too. They created this whole chemistry between the two of them.
Yeah,
really flirtatious and fun, and you know, like spatting with each other and sparring, and it was, and Awkwafina, I remember her saying, I can't believe that I get to be with the person that I'm talking to. Usually you go in and you do your voice and you don't need to be, but it so fed us.
Yeah.
And it made such a difference.
Material.
It did, yeah.
Oh, good.
And Jacob too.
Jacob, yes.
I mean, they were all there in rehearsal because we realized that, you know, listen, you're going to have to ultimately play a scene with like a mark on your shoulder, right? Like, you know, I mean, that's what Triton is talking to, you know, a puppet on his shoulder. And so, but that relationship has to be embedded. I mean, it's important to create that reality. Once again, this is the genre that we're in. It's a live action genre, so it has to feel real.
Yeah. Can we talk a little bit about the father relationship?
Yes.
I mean, for me, that was like one of the real strengths of the movie. Mm. It's such a grounding, he's such an amazing presence.
Yes.
You know, did you always imagine him in the casting? Like, was there any sort of, was there any changes as you got him involved
well,
in the film?
It's interesting.
That was another serendipitous event.
Well, here's the thing. We've always wanted to work with Javier. We've known him for a very, very long time. We know Penelope, his wife.
Yeah, we worked
and
with her a couple times.
And so she's...
Comes in useful.
Yes. And she's incredible. And we decided, you know... We actually, do you want to hear the crazy
Tell
story?
Tell the story. That's
Thanks.
A great
the crazy story.
Story
is we,
stories,
were,
yeah.
we were grocery shopping, hand to God.
And it's true.
And we were in one aisle, and we were talking, and I said to John.
We were discussing.
I said, John, don't you think Javier would be brilliant as Triton? I mean, we need...
Just talking.
Well, we need an actor who has great depth, but also is, you know, has great emotion, too, and can play the full sort of the power and also the vulnerability of the character, right? The whole range. And I said, don't you think Javier would be great? Also, he's a god, but he's also his daughters of the seven seas, so it has to be sort of international and diverse. It just feels like so right for him. Then we were like maybe three aisles over. Rang my phone. It's Javier. This is the truth.
Out of the blue.
Wow.
And he said, and he literally says, hello, da da da. He said, would you ever consider me for the role of Triton? I took the phone, literally threw it into the...
So you're like, the frozen food.
In the frozen fish section.
It was the craziest thing.
Isn't that bizarre?
Yes.
And it was like, wow, I mean, so the gods... I said, well, and we told Javier the story.
We said,
Javier,
we were
talking about this. Yeah. Of course it's you. It's
those
perfect.
Things you can't believe.
Because he wanted to play too. I think it's because
mentally
also...
Mentally summoned him.
Mm. Also, we wanted to work together, but also he has a young daughter. And a young son, and I think they, in what you were just saying about the relationship, I mean, it's a very simple story ultimately, right? Mm. It's about a father learning to let go, let his child go. It's not what he's obviously holding on for a loving way, protecting her, but ultimately has to learn to let her live her life, and it's not the life he had planned for her. It's a different life,
and in doing so, changes him. He learns about. That's what you learn.
But I think that's what happens to a lot of parents. Mm-hmm. They see their trajectory of their child in a certain way, but it doesn't always work out. Normally doesn't work out like that.
You're not going to have their own.
No.
And he sees that he was just, in a sense, kind of fomenting this fear in her and in his whole kingdom, which was very moving to us.
Yes, and I think you need, you know, what's kind of, very profound about it is that you really realize that it takes a young spirit like Ariel or like Eric to teach the sort of older parents and people about not being afraid because they don't see it. They don't live in that. They don't have the fear and they don't have the history and all of that.
It's a really interesting point, actually. I think that's something that happens as you get older. You just naturally become more and more fearful of life.
Yes.
You just do.
And kids just do not have any fear. Like, they go to school, they play around, they jump off trees.
Yeah, you don't see death.
You know, you don't see death, And it's such a valuable thing that they can teach us.
That's why if you can keep the child in you alive, you know, that's really so important.
That's what we try and do as filmmakers. Yeah. Yeah. Yes. Try and keep that innocent child, the storyteller.
Yes, how do you see it? Exactly.
Yeah. And it's hard.
Tap that. I will say Hans Christian Andersen, going back to that and going back to the original tale, helped us see it fresh and keep that alive and see what that was, because it's such a classic, timeless piece. That, you know, and here you are, it's a beloved animated film, so, but we're doing something else with it. We're reimagining it, you know, obviously holding on to the bones and the structure and all the things that are loved about it. But at the same time, you are doing something else and expanding it. So it was...
understanding Hans Christian Andersen's life and what he, you know, reading up about him and the sad, drastic kind of outsider that he felt his whole life and never would fit into this... world that he wasn't a part of.
Yes. I mean, all his tales are like the Ugly Duckling. It's always the outsider.
Yeah.
You know, Thumbelina, like all these struggling characters that don't feel like they belong. And this is a classic version.
So what was the process of reimagining this from a sort of a script studio perspective? Okay, we're going to remake The Little Mermaid. Like, how does that start? Like, what are the processes?
It was just John, David McGee, who wrote the screenplay, and myself, the three of us in a room, just starting at the top and saying, well, let's sort of work through this. I mean, I remember the first thing we saw was the film opens, two things. The mermaid's already up above the surface, sort of seeing what's happening in the world. And the first thing I remember I said...
Very important to Rob.
Well, I just said, I said, you know what? Let's make it that she's never broken the surface. Let's raise the stakes.
Yes. This father.
So she's so she's never been up there. That's why we changed Scuttle from a seagull to it's a diving bird. So she only learns all the information below the surface. She's never been up there. It's not until after she sings Part of Your World that she can't help herself and goes to the surface. So that was number one. Number two, there was an opening song, Fathoms Below, which was like the sailor singing a sort of sailing song. And it felt to me immediately very musical theater, very musical comedy. Mm-hmm. I mean, I understand it in the animated film because it's already an artificial genre. But it felt too musical-y to us because we're trying to create an actual real world above. So we came up with this idea of taking that song, Fathoms Below, and actually putting it later as a sea shanty that they'd be singing in sort of a celebration.
Celebrating his birthday on the,
Nice. So it felt more organic, more natural. I mean, for me, the goal when you're doing a musical, it's really fine line. You have to really earn a song. It has to feel completely organic, like it comes literally from the story, and you're not aware that they're singing. Because if we all know when you see a musical where they start to sing and it's slightly embarrassing or a little awkward, you're like, well, this is not good. And it's because it hasn't come grown naturally out of the story. And so so our first musical number is not until 15 minutes into the film. But it had to be earned. It can't just start. Every musical has their own kind of, trajectory, how it works. But this one felt like, well, you know what? This is our Somewhere Over the Rainbow, right? This is our I Want song. It's the motor on which the entire rest of the film was built, but we had to get there. She had to have a fight with her father, so she feels really trapped, so she feels she has to sing about what she wants and why she's not afraid of the people up there. And so it was a really interesting, as we worked through step by step, we really were just trying to see this as a live action piece. That was the goal. And then you made all the adjustments and started work on where new songs would come.
That was a big deal too. After we knew, structurally what we wanted to say and how we wanted to say it from beginning to end, then we did go through and see. We knew we had to flesh out with some new songs. I kind of like the animated that there aren't so many songs. I enjoy that in a musical. I don't think it needs to be song, 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 but we knew we needed another song for Ariel.
Yeah, she only had one song in the animated film.
It's outrageous.
She needed another.
She sings Part of Your World, that's it. So you go, well, that's all she sings. I mean, there's a few reprises, but that's it. And so we thought we need, and we felt like it needs to be in an important place. It needs to be where she sings it in the film, which is her experience for the first time on land. Like, what is that experience? We want to understand what that's like. And of course...
And I know it was very important for you. I remember when we were dealing in these sessions that you didn't want to make it all, oh, this is a great place, and now here we go. You know, so it has to be harsh for her. You know,
a combination of beautiful.
Even the
and
moment
harsh.
She breaks the surface, these things are bombs are going off. It's fireworks, which we love and adore, but it's scary. I mean, it's one thing.
Well, because it's
her.
New, you know, you're a fish out of water, you know. So what
so
is
that
this
was
like?
Fun? That whole montage. And what we do, we decide where the songs will be, then we in turn give it to our music.
Yes,
Alan Menken and Lynn Miranda, and then we kind of say what needs to be covered in this song. And then they come back and then we have the dialogue and then we create.
I mean, we showed them where we felt the placements were and they were like, this feels right, that feels right. We made some adjustments to things. We realized Eric needed a song. What is he feeling? What's his journey? That was really important to find that song. We thought it'd be fun to have Scuttle have a song because Scuttle, I mean, Sebastian has two songs, basically, Under the Sea and Kiss the Girl.
Mm-hmm. What a timeless classic that is.
It's so wonderful.
It's been in my head.
Under the Sea is very hard to get out of your head.
Oh, yeah, please.
Were Disney always on board? Was it ever an issue, like from the very beginning? Was it always like, great, go ahead, make it. Great, put a song in there. Great. Or was there any fight back? Was there any issues?
Well, you know, it's interesting. You know, this is our fourth movie in a row with them. We have such a great relationship with them. They trust us implicitly. The respect's unbelievable. Yeah. They really trusted us to go do our thing. And that comes from Sean Bailey, 100%, Alan Bergman, Bob Iger. They just let us go.
All the ideas we had, they really embraced them all.
Well, because we also, I think we're aware what it needs to be, too. We're not going to take it and throw the baby out with the bathwater. We're going to, like, say, okay, all these things need to be here. How can we make it a deeper and fuller and more emotional experience, but also keep the fun of it and the joy? I mean, there's a lot of joy in the film, obviously, too, you know? I mean, just speaking of Under the Sea, that was, without a doubt, the most challenging production number we've ever had to do because there was one live actor in it. That's it. Mm-hmm. And there's millions of sea creatures in it.
Yes.
So how do we begin that?
And they're playing instruments in the animated. And we're like, no, I don't think our fish can play instruments.
Yeah, we're trying to create a photoreal world.
Yeah,
you know,
as great as it was.
So you can't have like a fluke playing the sax.
No.
You
know? And they're all based on, all those are real fish. Those are real fish that even the feather that become her boa. And those are all.
Yeah. So how do you integrate that?
Yeah.
I remember saying to John, you know, I remember that Walt Disney himself had worked with the Ballet Russe company when they created Fantasia, like a ballet company, so that his animators would have something, a form to sort of work to sketch from, like a template. And so I said, John, we should get a company, a dance company. So we brought the Alvin Ailey Company over from America to London, where we were at Pinewood Studios, and we created it on them. So we built the whole number on them. And they were all playing different sea creatures. So they were trying to mimic what they were. So either a feather starfish or a flatworm or a mimic octopus. These are all these crazy jellyfish, all these. And we were trying to literally have them play these. As the jellyfish, we were working with umbrellas, also having tentacles, but also they, you know, their legs could be moving. We tried to replicate what each creature was, and we did it on their bodies so that our CGI artists would have a template to work from. Beautiful. So the whole thing could be danced. And it was so complicated to communicate that to the artists, but we had everything was done. I mean, every single movement of that, every little feather, all of that is choreographed to a T. It looks like, wow, just like
again, the preparation.
They're just having fun.
Yeah. That was key in this whole process. Yeah.
But it was, I mean, there's one point at the finale of the number when there are like hundreds and hundreds of creatures up there, and every one of them is choreographed. So it was, and it was daunting. And once again, we don't want people to see that. They're like, oh, this just looks like everything's just happening.
But it's like
chicken or the egg. How do you start that? And we built it from scratch, storyboards, previs, all of that on their bodies. The whole thing was shaped step by step, shot by shot.
It's brilliant how you actually taking these sort of musical theater ideas and turning them into animated live action principles and actually that give it authenticity.
Coming from the choreography background as well.
That helped us.
Yeah, yeah.
That helped us. The fact that we
had
that.
I mean, I don't know anyone on the planet that could do this movie, but this one.
No, because
your musicality and your just awareness of the camera and movement. And I mean, it's crucial. Under the Sea.
I mean, you know.
It really, really as we again, we always say we just want people to have a good time and feel the emotion, but it was very complicated.
It really
and comes, you yes. need patience because you can't go. You have to go from point A to point B and take baby steps. I mean, the methodology meetings we would have on this with all our creatives would sit around these tables, and it was exhausting.
How do we do this?
We had to crack it.
That's why this took 4.5 years.
Because it was 2018-ish around then when you sort
exactly,
of the announcement.
Yeah. Fall of 2018 we started writing. And then in 2019 we started doing some early prep.
Were you always going to do it kind of on sound stages ish with CGI?
We knew we had to because you have to sing and you have to speak and play scenes. So there's just no version of doing it underwater. So we knew we had to create that world, and thank God
we wanted always to have movement to everything.
I mean, we had our team from Chicago, the film Chicago. Yes. So literally almost over 20 years ago now, that team. Wow. Because we needed
we keep
A
them
team.
Close by.
I was gonna say,
well, we needed our
very
A
loyal
team. Colleen Atwood, John Meyer, Dion Beebe. We needed all the people, and then Tim Burke, our visual effects supervisor, who's a genius.
Joey Pizzi and Tara Nicole.
We needed every person. Yeah, movement. Exactly.
Everyone.
So, but you're right though when you say it's sort of like has a, sort of a theater. I mean, I always feel that musicals on film are a hybrid of theater and film, because you have to rehearse it almost like a musical, like you would do it. Of course, you're going to then do something completely different when you're filming and all of that. But there is a process that's very similar.
Mm. How did you approach the action scenes? Like, let's talk about the ship getting blown to
that's real fire.
Yeah,
was it?
Yeah. That's real fire.
Were you? Because it felt very real a lot of the time.
It was
on that
freezing
ship.
Cold.
And it was water coming up.
Yes,
a lot of that water's. I mean, most of that water's real. What we did was we were in the back lot at Pinewood Studios.
Right. Okay.
So we had a gimbal that was 3 stories high. So a gimbal is something a mechanism that's underneath that rocks the boat, especially you know when there's a shipwreck goes you know really goes flying. But we also had huge dump tanks and rain, real rain, because that's all interactive. So you can't add that. So the rain and the lightning and all those big sort of big masses of water that was all being poured right on top of them. Wow. Huge tanks of water that were filling the ship. And then, as John just said, when we got to the moment where the ship goes on fire, that was all real fire because we have a great team there. Mm-hmm. And
it's Pinewood.
And it was just, but also we could actually work with it too. I mean, it was very. I mean, you can do it in such a way where it's not dangerous to the actor. Yeah. Mm. But it helped the actors though. I think really feel like they were in a shipwreck. You know, things were breaking. We had broken rails that could break, and it was
again. It's like a musical number. That's the fun. Yeah,
huge musical number.
Yes,
but
yes.
The whole film felt that way, and it felt. Actually, I really enjoyed it. It was really glorious to watch.
Oh,
it was literally
so lovely to
hear.
Yeah.
That's
funny.
I still really enjoy watching that, to be honest.
Right.
I really like the shipwreck. Yeah.
Well, because it starts as a storm. And then it turns into a shipwreck. So you have like two things happening at the same time. I have to say the fact that we had done Pirates of the Caribbean helped a lot, having had work on the ship before.
Of course.
It was very
reasonable
very,
prep.
Yes, exactly.
And we had mermaids. We made everybody watch that actually.
Oh, really?
Because we liked how that came out a lot.
Yeah. Well, because
so
I mean, before
down.
They turned into killing machines.
Yeah.
But,
they really the killers.
But it was.
No, well, we learned a lot.
This is the
You're
prequel.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah, but we learned how to work with actors who. Or, you know, how they're going to have tails and how they're going to move and the look of that. That was helpful.
And also how to work on a ship and how actors need to behave and move, especially when they haven't, like these pirates, not in the Pirates of the Caribbean, in this one, they're supposed to be on a ship, they're sailors.
Mm. Yes, exactly.
Whereas you've got actors who are, we're rehearsing for a couple of months or whatever, and it's a very different
feeling.
Well,
you know, it's interesting, we had a lot of stunt guys on that, obviously, there with their incredible, with Adam Curley, who's our wonderful stunt coordinator, but also we had dancers.
Yes.
So because we can speak, they speak our language.
Yeah.
And so when we're doing something like Fathoms Below, but also a lot of the stunt work, they can do that kind of thing too because they know
dancers are there. If you tell them to be at that moment in that point in time,
so
they are there.
Yeah, and stunt people too.
Mm. And stunt people too.
They're like dancers. I mean, so you know, it's really
helpful. Like two sides of the same coin.
Yes.
Yeah.
But we loved choreographing that. That I mean, I have to say that felt, you know. When we're not, because everybody else, we were on wires and like crazy contraptions and apparatus underwater doing that whole thing. So when we were actually above the surface. It was like, wow, we're doing like a movie. Now this was the other thing was like, wow, this was so complicated.
Yeah, I imagine. And just jumping back, you mentioned Chicago there. 20 years ago surprises me, but it was 20 years ago.
Yeah, technically, us too a little bit.
Technically, it was your first sort of something else. You did Annie before, but yet you're now doing a musical. I know you're heavily involved as well. Just talk us through the difference, if you don't mind, sure, from that, how it felt, just for our filmmakers out there, the difference between that first film, and being a huge first film, by the way, to this, which is now, you know, who you are, what you've both achieved.
Wow, that's such a great question.
It really is. Like, I rush back to that.
I mean, you know, the interesting thing about Chicago is that because all the numbers, I mean, in terms of the concept that I worked,
you figured
that I created,
out, yeah.
Which was that
all
the
from Roxy's. Yeah.
Well, I mean, the bottom line is that the musical numbers in that film took place on a stage, all of them, because they needed to, because they were created that way. They were all created literally as vaudeville turns. So they were all vaudeville numbers, presentational numbers to an audience. They weren't like sitting in a, you know, a room and talking.
Burst out into song.
No, they were actually on stage.
Which helped.
So bridging that from my theater background, as an example, our theater background, was very helpful because we were doing stage numbers.
Sure.
So, okay. And this compared to that is completely different because there was nothing stagey about this. You know, this had to feel, this was environmental in a way. Everything,
we couldn't just turn the lights on and do a number.
Yeah,
you know? No, which you'd love to, but yeah, we'd all love to.
It would have been fun.
There's no proscenium. You know, you're basically underwater. You know, so I mean, you know, so we had to break it apart in a completely different way. I mean, as an example, Part of Your World, her first number. When we first did this, we said, let's just start on our feet because we can't put her up in the air. You know, how are we going to even work on this number? So we actually built three different sets next to each other. The lowest part of the grotto, her grotto, where her little rock is. The middle part of her grotto, where she sits and she lies down on the sand, all of that kind of thing. And then the top portion of the grotto, where she reaches, you know, to the opening.
Yeah.
So that way, when we were working on it, we'd start in one, she would walk to the other, and she would walk back. So we would do that. And then, after we knew what we were playing, what she was playing as an actor, what she was feeling, and what the sort of quote-unquote blocking was, then we moved into putting her on a rig. And as I think you were saying before, there were many different rigs that we would use. So there's sometimes she would be on wires because she needed to just go up and sit and lie back or something. Then there'd be something where she actually needs to move and spin, so she'd be on a different rig. And
the filming was so painstaking because we have to keep changing.
It wasn't like just put them on a stage.
The demands were for physicality.
So I think
you're kind of inventing new things basically for
exactly.
movement.
You're
basically reinventing movement.
We were just
using our imaginations because, as Rob says, it was a horizontal world that we were dealing with, but it will be a vertical world. So we had to know that, oh, she has to get from there to there as opposed to there to there.
It was kind of, it was scientific in many ways, too. But,
It's almost like thinking, like, in the perspective of a camera, you know, like moving from a dolly up to a jib or vice versa.
Exactly.
Like, think of it as an entity
needs to move. Well, with each move, too, we had a different camera. So there'd be different kind of, you know, a lot of our cameras were, I mean, the majority of the film was on a crane because it needed to float. It couldn't be so earthbound as a dolly or something like that. It had to kind of float. And we always had a little float. And it's also just a little kind of, we would literally just kind of go back and forth a little like this, too. So
keep
that
saying to Dion, we need to feel.
Yeah, I mean, it
was. Whoosh of the ocean. Yes. Yeah.
I mean, it just had to rock a little. So you always felt like we were kind of just moving like that. I mean, that's what the challenge. I mean, that's why I feel like if we hadn't done all these prior movies, even Mary Poppins Returns, that big animation sequence.
Yeah, we had two different sequences in that really helped us.
And a lot of those were on wires and things like that too. To have had that experience was like a little prep for this film, but not quite. I mean, this was really like the most challenging film ever.
If you had some advice to give yourselves as younger filmmakers, maybe you're struggling to get that first break, might you have something to tell the audience or someone else that's starting in their kind of journey?
I mean, I always say, no matter what you're doing, just do it. Like, work breeds work. In other words, if you work on something, it doesn't matter if it's in your basement. I don't care if it's on the street. The thing is, you're learning. and you're just putting it out there. People are, I think a lot of people these days want to jump. Mm. You know, I started as a performer. I never took a film class in my life. Mm. I moved into becoming a dance captain and an assistant choreographer, and then a choreographer, and then a director. This was all on stage before I did anything on film. So, but there was, you know, you have to take the steps, because I don't think it just happens like all of a sudden that you come down and you're boom, you're this. You know, whatever steps you're taking, and I think you have to just approach everything you're doing as if it's really important. You know, you're not just like waiting for the big break. It's like, it doesn't work like that. You have to just, you have to give everything you have. Don't be, yeah. And don't be afraid to work small.
We live in a very like immediate kind of culture now, where everybody wants it now, and they see how easy things are to get. And that's not how we work.
No.
We kind of, again, talk about foundations. We both really just took our steps.
And there's no, I don't think there's any, there's no plan that works for everybody. Like, everybody has their own trajectory. It, you know, I mean, I have to say, I felt when I started working on film, I felt more at home even than in the theater. Mm. I've always said this to you, John, that when I would think about staging something on stage, I would always imagine the film in my head first and then translate it to a proscenium stage, you know? So, and I realized when we started working on film that I didn't need to make that translation or transition to that. I could just, it's already there. Because film, there's no boundaries, you see. It opens, you can do anything. You have all the, almost too much flexibility.
We were just talking about this the other day.
Yeah.
Because we were both saying, as kids, we both thought movies were what we, in our minds, that was our imagination. Yeah. We're films more than theater, but we started in theater.
Yeah.
It's odd.
Yes.
Yeah. So it was a natural. And we tried to work in theater together, and it lasted for like one afternoon. We couldn't. We were in a rehearsal room, and we both had to like be the chiefs, if you know what I mean.
Yes.
Neither of us were willing to like take the back seat.
Yeah. Yeah.
But then Robbie went to do Chicago and said, "You have to come." And I said, "No, no, no." He said, "No, movies are so big. I need you on this."
Yes, and it's so helpful to have John as a collaborator, because we have a very similar vision about things, but also at the same time, there is so much to do on a film, and so much to prepare, and so much to that to have John as a partner, a creative partner as we're working, is invaluable. And so it's been wonderful. It's also, you know, it's your life. So it's 4.5 years of your life. Oh. So it's this massive journey.
Well, we are similar, but we also are different. Yes. I mean, we are. Yeah. I mean, I'm always...
Well, that's true.
Well, I still am talking about changes to this movie. And he's like, John,
it's too late now.
Slowly I turn.
It's amazing you've created such a partnership. But we have to wrap this up, I'm afraid.
Oh, goodness. What a joy to be with you.
Yeah,
you
such guys a pleasure.
Just amazing. A joy. Just bless wonderful.
You. Thank you.
Amazing. Even with your Top Gun Maverick.
You know, I love you took it off.
I know, you did take it.
I'm loyal to
you. Could have sat there like this the whole time.
Yeah, you could have
just kind of...
pledged my allegiance to Little Mermaid.
That's what we believe in.
The Filmmakers Podcast. What a pleasure.
No, but you're really interested. You don't look at cards. You're like right here with us.
Yeah, what a joy.
This is what we
a total joy.
Die for.
A total
so
joy.
Thank you.
We could have gone on forever.
Oh, I know.
We've stood up waiting.
You heard the bell go on?
Yeah, a few times. Bell's already gone.
You guys are amazing. What a great film. It's out now. Go watch it.
Yeah, but you're natural filmmakers too.
Yeah,
we can see.
We are, yes.
100%.
Because you're interested, you're open.
You can tell.
Thank you.
You can tell. You have it. You have it.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Good luck, guys.
Thank you so much. Such a pleasure. Thank you.
Well, there we have it. Wasn't that fun? Weren't they a delight? And they were so nice to me and Dom as well. They actually thought we were actual decent presenters and we could do that.
Yes. Definitely gonna use that clip.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, I don't know how we got away with that. We must have been nodding in the right way at the right times. No.
All things considered, we are competent filmmakers, and it's quite nice when people that are top Hollywood producer directors notice such and even tell us.
Yes.
It's very. It makes all this hard work that we we do bring these nuggets of information worthwhile.
It does. It does indeed. I love chatting to them. I felt very at ease, I think, after the first couple of minutes. But it's a shame because we were actually we were chatting away before they managed to turn over. Yes. So, and all that stuff was just lovely stuff. And then suddenly they turn over and you go, oh, we have to do a proper hello type welcome. And it's you've already done
it. Welcome.
And it's always a bit eggy. But actually, such lovely gentlemen, really nice, cared about filmmaking, cared about filmmakers. And I hope you got so much out of that. I, do you know what I thought we could touch on? Because it was, I think it was about a 35-minute interview. And we've got a bit of time. Why not talk about what they said? Which is long-standing collaborations and the fact that they have this amazing relationship. To make that many films together and be that successful is ridiculous. You know, so and I thought it'd be really interesting for our filmmakers to talk about that and how hard it is and how you've got to really cultivate and really work hard to...
Just like yoga.
You work really hard to sustain those relationships, just like yoga. You know, if your yogurt's going to go mouldy because you don't put it in the fridge, that's your fault. Yeah. You need to look after it and care for it.
You need good bacteria. I mean, that's a good metaphor, actually. Good bacteria. You need good people in your collaborations. Work with a Yakult, not a mouldy yogurt.
Make sure they're vegan as well because they go off less. It's so true. It's fact. But yeah, I think that's really interesting and how you can do that and how they have done that. And they got on so well as well. They're partners in real life. You know, that's not easy, you know. So hard to work with your partners. I know so many of our brilliant filmmakers who work with their partners. It's not easy. It's really difficult. And the fact that they've hit the top and stayed there, and it's not easy.
It really helps. It really helps to have someone, you know, to collaborate with. It does make life a lot easier when you've got, like, a bouncing board.
Yes.
Someone that's sort of got your back.
Yeah.
And someone that sort of understands the shorthand and is in it for the sort of the easy and the harder stuff.
Well, that's it, because it is hard. Filmmaking is really hard. You know, look, even Rob Marshall and John DeLuca, who have got a lot of money behind them and have got a lot of success, but that doesn't mean it's easy. It might be easier in certain stages to go, well, we need to pre-vis this, we need to do this, this is what we need, the script needs this work. Well, you can afford to do it. And obviously, when you're starting out, it's very difficult to do that. So, and of course, there's going to be problems when you're on set, before, afterwards, all the issues with that. And of course, you're going to fall out. And I think that's testament to great relationships in this business, is if you can, you know, you can say how you feel, you can get out what you need to get out, but at the same time, you love each other and you care about each other and you go, look, okay, sorry about that. That was me being a shit. Forgive me. And you go, no worries, I get it. We're under stress, we're under pressure. We all are, and things can go wrong. And those long-lasting relationships are, you know, if you get them in this industry, they're the best. They really are.
Mm. You and Jack, lovely collaboration.
Yeah, exactly. Me and Lucinda have made 4 films together. Absolutely.
Yes, that's true, yeah.
The list goes on with certainly Andrew Roger, myself.
Alexa War, she's awesome.
Yep. You see, and these kind of relationships, it's true. You become really good friends when you shoot films with people. And you connect because you go through absolute hell together and you go through joy together. There's a lot less joy. Those joys are very few and far between. But the sense of achievement is massive. And it's so hard to put into words that when you play, it's like if you're playing a tennis game, you're on your own winning that match. Or if you're playing doubles, then that's the difference.
It's like breaking your ankle in a tennis game.
What?
Just making films as an independent filmmaker.
That's really, I get it now. Yeah. It really is.
And then when you've got the broken ankle, it's like someone has lined up 3 or 4 of the ball machines on the other side of the net. They remove the net and then they're just firing the balls at your head. As you try to crawl away.
This is just one of your fantasies. Because... I like this metaphor though. That's quite funny. It's quite visual. I had a visual of you on the floor.
Yeah.
Problem was you were in pain and I didn't like that. But I like the idea of someone firing balls at your head.
Yeah. Well, okay. Oh, thank you. No, I think it's I think actually, you know, it comes down to collaborations and really it doesn't have to be all suffering. It doesn't have to be like a sort of enormously over serious environment. And actually, you know, if you work with the right people, you will have the sort of the joyous moments and the fun and the stress free parts of your shooting experience as well.
Yes. So true.
Yeah, it's definitely not all gloom and gloom. I had a good tennis visualization, and I wanted to roll with it. So here we are.
Yes. When does Sean Connery like to finish his tennis games?
About tennis.
That was horrible.
It really was. I apologise.
Double fault.
There's some other amazing collaborations who've been on the podcast. Spielberg and Christy McCusker-Krieger, who's been on the podcast episode 219, not that long ago, talking about that collaboration. How many films she's made with him. How incredible that experience must be to have that connection, and for Spielberg to have an amazing producer around him that he can trust as well. Simon Pegg, Edgar Wright, another couple there, you know, thinking about that type of people. And anyway, basically, I think what we're saying is find those people. And when you do find them, cultivate those relationships and make them the best you can, because they're few and far between. Great producers or great directors or great teammates, cinematographers, crew members. Yeah.
We can learn a lot from yoga, really, can't we?
We can learn a lot from yoga. Yeah. I once saw yoga floating across my kitchen.
Yeah.
I think it might be paranormal activity.
Oh, God.
So for those of you who saw us out in Cannes, thank you so much for coming up and saying how much you enjoy the podcast. I really appreciate that. And for those of you I hadn't met before, that was really nice as well. So much love. It's really nice to hear, isn't it, Dom?
Yeah, it is. It's very nice. I think I got just as many people saying they enjoyed my memes as my podcasting or film work, which is a sort of a compliment in itself, I guess, as long as people are happy. That's the main thing.
That's the main thing, Dom, as long as you make them happy.
Yes. But I think also as well, an apology if there is anyone listening and you tried to send a message to funny guy. If there's anyone who tried to send a message to meet up and I didn't reply, sorry, but it's just a chaotic, truly chaotic.
So rude.
Time. I tried. I really tried.
Yeah.
And I think like most people, you know, generally if they know what you look like, they can come and say hello to you when you're at something, and you know that's a good way to say hello. But it is hard to, you know, to actually set aside coffee meets. Like, usually it's just, you know, you've just got back-to-back meetings and then you're meeting, struggling to see everyone as it is. So it's a difficult time, and I appreciate anyone that does reach out, and I'm sure Giles does as well.
I absolutely do. And thank you so much for those who listened. Honestly, it means a lot. So big hello back to you guys and girls for taking the time to listen. And hopefully learning something from this, which I do every time. Right, until next Tuesday, when we have on either Rob Savage talking about Boogeyman that me and Dom went to watch the other day, which was
Savage.
Fantastic. Yeah. Was Savage. Yeah. It was frightening. Yeah. Dom did jump on me a few times and grab me. And that was just before we went in.
I was just going to say.
And then also Chevalier as well. We're talking to the director of Chevalier and some of the stars as well. So it's one of those two next week. How exciting for you all.
Yeah.
Absolutely. We will see you then, or you'll see us on YouTube if you do want to go watch this interview that myself and Dom had with Rob Marshall and John DeLuca. If not, you take care. Go out there and make your films. Make something happen for you. And if you're lucky enough to rise up and do well, it's your job to send the yogurt back down.
Well, actually, if you send the yogurt back down, then the yogurt might come back up again, so... Especially if it was the one from your fridge.
Yes, because it's developed a culture.
Yeah.
So,
yes.
Okay, until next Tuesday, no more puns. It's enough.
We went a bit overboard. Sorry, everyone.
To be honest, there were so many yogurt-based jokes that it started to turn sour. So, until next Tuesday... Sorry, I'm just googling some more jokes. 1 minute.
Yeah.
Any more? Is there anything here? You can have a joke like this delivered on the hour every hour. Now by following us on Twitter or liking us on Facebook. This is what you should put on your Twitter
bio. For every like, Giles will not make a joke.
Anyway, this has been utterly brilliant. Until next Tuesday. Take care, everyone.
Yeah.
Bye, Dom.
Bye, Giles.
Bye.